One thing that I've always been super curious about is how other games handle particles.
So let's say you blow up an enemy in a video game, for instance.
How exactly is that handled, like in code?
Is it added to the scene, or is it like attached to the model? Let me show you how I used to do it.
This is one of the enemies in my game. It acts just like creepers do in Minecraft. It chases you around and after some time, it blows up. Pause. Right here. What would you do right here if you want particles to show up right when this enemy blows up? In the before times, how I'd handle things like explosions or bullet impacts or, well, any temporary visual or audio cue is that I would make an animation player node. This node would handle the entire explosion sequence. Step 1, trigger the animation. Step 2, the animation makes the enemy model invisible. Poof, gone. Step 3, disable all the processing on the enemy object while it's invisible and inert. The same animation player triggers the particle effects and plays the explosion sound. And lastly, once the particles fade and the sound finishes, the animation player deletes the entire node. And yeah, that's how it goes. Personally, I just feel like it's super messy, incredibly inefficient, and prone to disaster. The obvious problem being that I would do this for every single object in the game. And the effects logic was tied directly to the objects producing it. If I wanted to reuse an explosion effect, I'd have to copy and paste nodes and animation data. If I wanted to change how an explosion looked or sounded across the board, I'd have to edit potentially dozens of different objects. Which has happened and is super tedious, tightly coupled, and just asking for trouble. Also, did you know that if you connect the finished signal on a particle to the Q-free method
of another node
and then emits the particle, it'll actually delete itself like in editor. Anyways, I came up with a solution that's probably just how every other game does it.
And I think it's actually quite brilliant, just like the sponsor of today's video. Now, as the self-taught game developer that I am, one of my weakest points in game development has to be vector math. But I found on Brilliant, they have a bunch of interactive lessons that make it so easy to learn. And not just math, Brilliant has thousands of interactive lessons in science, data analysis, programming, and even how AI works. You can learn all of these through challenges and interactive lessons at your own pace, and even on the go. The Brilliant app makes it super easy for you to learn anywhere because it's literally on your phone. And because it makes it easy for you to become consistent by building habits, you learn more effectively. Try Brilliant for free for 30 days. You can click the link in my description to get 20% off a premium annual subscription. Thanks again to Brilliant for sponsoring today's video.
Enter the effect system.
The idea is pretty simple.
Instead of each object carrying its own baggage of particle emitters and sound players, here's how the new system works. At its heart is a globally accessible manager, sometimes called a singleton. Think of it as the game's dedicated special effects coordinator. This effect manager keeps track of a few things. Firstly, it holds a reference to all the available particles and sound effects in the game.
One list holds all the particle scenes and the other list holds all the sound scenes.
Why am I using sound scenes instead of just audio files, you might be asking? Well, sometimes I want a sound to be positional. You know, it gets louder as you get closer. Sometimes I want a global sound that plays everywhere. Sometimes I might want to layer multiple sounds together. Making them scenes gives me that flexibility. Now, the real magic happens in the third list. It's a collection of custom game objects I've defined. In Godot, we call these special data containers, resources. They just hold information that I can easily access and reuse across different parts of my game. It's super handy. And for instance, I actually use this exact concept when defining different parts of the player's weapon. So, an effect resource in my system basically bundles everything together. It links a specific particle scene and a specific sound scene, and some extra parameters like
should this effect cause camera shake, and if so, how much?
She did freeze the frame for a split second to add impact. Let's take a look at how this new system works using the enemy from the beginning of the video. When the bomber enemy is about to go boom, right before the actual enemy object is removed from the game,
it executes this line of code, basically telling the effect system to add the bomber explosion effect in this position.
The effect system then looks up the bomber explosion effect in its list of effects resources. Now, if you look inside the resource for this effect, it points to the explosion sound effect. It also points to the explosion particle effect, and it has some parameters defining its camera shake. The effect system then looks up the linked particle scene and sound scene. Then it simply creates instances of those scenes at that specified location. Both the particle scene class and the sound scene class basically do the same thing. When they're added to the scene, they immediately play the sound or emit the particles that are its children. Then they wait till the last particle has been emitted or the sound has finished playing. Then they are deleted from the game scene. Crucially, the bomber object doesn't need to know anything about the particle nodes, audio players, or camera controllers. It just makes a request to play the bomb explosion here, and the effect system just does the rest. The beauty of this is reusability,
like what you just saw with the spawn dust. All the bullets run this line of code when they hit a wall.
And if the player gets hurt, then it just plays the hurt effect as well. And all the particle effects are basically centralized, so if I want to change how one effect that might be used across different scenes looks, I can just change them all from the specific particle scene. So that's the effect system as it stands. Of course, there's always more that could be done, but that's a solid foundation. If you think there's something I might have missed, then leave a comment and I'll see if I can put that in the next video. Of course, solving one problem often reveals another one. While the effects are handled more elegantly now, the actual gameplay is a bit repetitive. Especially with the enemies and how the levels are laid out, I kind of noticed that like I can basically clear an entire room without even moving forward. Like I can just stay at the bottom edge of this level and just clear an entire room over and over again. So I'm thinking in my next video I'm probably going to work on enemy AI as well as like some kind of aim assist, because aiming this can be a bit weird. You should probably subscribe for that, and yeah. See you later.